All right, so we're back with the fifth episode. You know, I've explained a lot about the kick, the bass line, mastering a track, arranging a track. I gave a few tips on the studio and how to build a melody. And now in this episode, I'm gonna answer as much questions as possible that people send in on socials at sandervandoorn.com throughout all the episodes. So let's get started. All right, so the first question I'm going to answer is how to make a track sound fatter and fuller. Well, you know, in my perspective, it all starts with the right kick and the right bass line. So in the first episode, I showed you a few tricks on how to build a kick and to create the perfect attack, and also to make sure that the bass line isn't conflicting with the kick by using ducking, by making sure the frequencies are balanced out right. So a good tip is always to look at the bass spectrum. So if you would take a channel EQ and you put the analyzer file on, so now it's on the as well as the kick and the bass line. So over here you see there's a lot of pressure on 50. This is actually the frequency that is going to create a lot more fullness in the track. We're working on a G note, so this area is on a note that's particularly full. A good tip is towards the 150 hertz to create a peak down. So this is a little bit too much. If you create a little bit of peak down over there, so you cut off that frequency a little bit more, you're going to make sure that your total mix can be pumped up a little bit more, so without the track being distorted. So that's a really tough frequency to edit. So I always recommend to cut off a little bit to make sure that this section over here, which is like a lower frequency, you can crank up a little bit more. So I'm gonna put this over here, and I'm gonna add some volume over there on that peak. So now you get a lot more bass. You have to be careful with that as well, so that you don't add too much, because then it's gonna sound way too fat, and it's not gonna sound nice in front of a crowd. But that's definitely a frequency you would love to play with. And also, you know, it's really important to make sure that the kick doesn't conflict with the bass line, you know, but ducking. For instance, here on the Matrix scheme, the bass isn't actually hitting the first kick. So that creates a little bit more room for the kick to be cranked up without it being distorted with the bass. Also, I made sure that the tail of the kick isn't that long, so it doesn't conflict with this area. If you get the perfect setting, I would also recommend, if you're really on for like a full fat track, to really first tackle the kick and the bass line, and then move on to the next section. Okay, so the second question was, can I use the first note of the kick even if the kick is there? Yeah, that's very much possible, but you know, that's usually a note that could create a few problems in your mix, because you're going to stack the frequency of your bass line on top of the frequency, which is also a low frequency of your kick. It's very much possible if you're, for instance, using like a high note with your bass line, for instance, like a C, you can perhaps use like a lower kick that's of a different frequency. So if I go here to the channel EQ, for instance, if your bass line is in this area, you can actually use the kick a little bit more in this area, so the two kicks doesn't conflict too much with each other. It's still, it's pretty tough and difficult. It's a lot of tweaking to get it right, You could also always use a little bit of a ducking device like Sidekick to make sure that you know, the two frequencies doesn't conflict too much with each other. You can also use a multipressor where you only duck the low section and you keep the high section straight. So then you can still hear the bass line, but the low section doesn't conflict with the kick. So that's also a very handy trip to use. So then you would use the multipressor in combination with sidechain. Yeah, so the third question is there any particular plugins specifically for bass lines? Well, in the first episode, I used the Trillion, this machine over here. It's for me, it's a really, really cool machine to use. The great thing about the Spectrasonics Trillion is it uses sample-based bass lines from all the old devices and some new devices as well, both recorded from analog devices as well as digital devices. So you have a massive library where you have your synth basses, you also have your guitar basses, also even a few synths that you can use as leads as well. But for me personally, this is one of the best plugins I use to create bass lines if I'm not using the Moog Voyager myself. Also, hardware-wise, the Virus C has a really good engine on creating bass lines. Also, the Massive Synth, I think it's a really cool plugin. It has a very specific sound when it comes to bass lines. Massive is used a lot, actually, to create bass lines. So that's also a really good plugin to use for that. So the next question is, can I use three attack parts of three different kicks to create a new kick? You can even use four or five if you want. You can. What you can do is, when you have like different attacks, so this is one attack where you would say, I'm gonna lower this one in volume a little bit, and I'm gonna use another attack which is gonna be more on top. In that way you can layer different kicks. You can use kicks with only the mid, so you cut off the high frequency, you know, until here, and then you have another kick that actually does exactly the opposite, only starts from here. Using different volumes, it's just basically tweaking, but you can stack up as much attacks on top of each other. Perhaps you actually create a completely new brilliant kick, so give it a try. Another question was, how do I organize my sounds? So I make sure I always find the right sound. Well, basically what I do is whenever I produce a project and I create a sound that I really like and, you know, I could perhaps, you know, tweak for another track. What I always do is I completely save the channel. So the whole channel with the instruments as well as the effects as a channel strip. On Logic, you have that function. And all the other DAWs, you have a similar function, well, on most of them, where you can save your completely sound together with the effects. For instance, I've got a few sounds saved over here. For instance, bass. This is like a C-length bass I made on a C-length over here. And so that's like a really cool, deep-sounding bass line. So I made it and I was like, wow, this is a really good sound. Then I saved it as a channel strip. So I made a complete library of all different sounds from all different synths. And also I made sure that all the hardware synths are coming in kind of like as a soft synth on in the project. So you can also save those settings a lot. It's very important you create your own library because, you know, it's very annoying when you're producing a track and you're like, oh man, I would like to use this sound I've used like a few years ago, but, you know, tweak it a little bit. Then you have a problem where you didn't save the sound. So it's always good to create your own library. All right, so somebody asked me, what's the brands that are there on your gray panel? Well, this is the gray panel over here. It's has different devices. Let's just start on the top. That's the TC Electronic Power Core. It's kind of like an effects unit that's driven by a separate processor. I wouldn't recommend buying that because there's no more software being produced for that particular device. So it's actually only there to fill up this whole unit. Below that is a Grace design. It's It's a monitoring system that's attached to the small piece over here as well, where you can switch between different monitors. The sound is digital. It has a really good clean sound. When I switch from the normal setup I previously had, which is normal analog, to this setup with Grace, all of a sudden the volume of my speakers rose very quickly. They were sounding a lot better, a lot cleaner, and a lot louder. So this is a really cool unit to use to combine different speakers in your studio. Below that is the Fireface from RME. This is a really good sound card for producing music. This is definitely something I can recommend for producers wanting to invest in a really good sound card. Below that is the TubeTech. This is like a really classic device. It's been going on for years. It's a tube compressor, a multipressor, which gives a really fat sounding analog sound. So this is a kind of like, has always been a bit of a secret. So a secret revealed. I usually throw a lot of mixes through the TubeTech to make it sound a little bit more analog. This is a really cool device to use in your for mastering a track. Over here as well, below is the Culture Vulture. It's also an analog tube distortion device. It's really cool to make distortions because it also uses the left and the right channel separately. So you can create a lot of a stereo image by just adding some distortion. So this is a really, really special device that has been used for years now. And I use this a lot for distorting a few sounds whenever possible. Also to make a kick sound a lot fatter, especially in combination with the TubeTech. So this is my gray panel over here. So another question was, how do I get ideas on how to drop a track? Well, that's pretty basically all about listening to a lot of tracks that are out there, finding the tracks that you find like work the best for you in your sets, and get inspired by it. Some drops can be very melodic. For instance, when I did the remix for Moby's Natural Blues, I really figured the track needed to be a little bit more melodic, so I chose for a melodic drop. Other tracks can have like a more stabby kind of drop. It's basically also just looking, finding sounds, creating sounds, and make sure that you have this distinctive sound that's kind of like sounds new, and you really focus your drop on that. So there's not like a real formula on how to make your perfect drop. It's a really personal process. But just basically listen to a lot of music out there and find your way. Yeah. So and the last question was, how long did it take me to get comfortable as a music producer with regards to mixing and synthesis? Well, for me personally, I've used a lot of years to actually learn how to produce music, learn how to play melodies, also how to make a sound. Synthesis is a process that can best be learned by just trying out different sounds, combining different sounds, using low frequency oscillators, as LFOs, just to combine and make your sound special, add detune to make it more fat, or just to create your own sounds. It took me quite a lot of time to get it perfect, and to be honest, every single track I produce for me is still like a big learning process. But for instance, when I first started to release my first track, I was already producing for 5 years when I felt comfortable enough to actually submit a track as a demo. So that's also a tip. Have a lot of people listening to your track, have a lot of advice given on how your track sounds or how it can be better. If you're a DJ, test out your track and make sure that it has the right quality standard before you send it to a record company. All right, guys, so that's it for the fifth episode. I hope it was a bit of a help for you guys for producing a track. There's something special coming up at the Amsterdam Dance Event this year, so keep an eye out on my socials. So anyway, thanks a lot for all the support, for watching these sessions, and hope to see you anytime soon. Cheers.